So I want to talk about slot composition, and I'm sure that most of you do not really know what that could actually mean. And so the first part of this talk has to be an introduction into what is slots and what is actually the problem that I want to solve. So I will do that in the first part. This is a bit of a repetition to some talk that was given some years ago to some extent, but I think it's good to have a common ground to start from. So in Smalltalk, we are really proud that everything is an object. But if you look at things, then at some point, after actually looking at all the objects that exist and play around a lot, you find things that are actually not objects. And one of those places is actually variables in the system. So if we look at, for example, point, a class that you use a lot in the system because it's used for everything in graphical, we know that we have two instance variables, x and y. But this x and y actually is not described by an object. The same for class variables. So if you find this class has a class variable, the definition is not an object, because if you look closely at the definition, this is just a string that you give there. And inside of the system, when it creates a class, it does not create an object that describes there is a variable, an instance variable x in a class point. So, yeah, instance variables, class variables, globals, they are all not objects, which might not be a big problem, but what comes directly from that is that the whole reflective API that has to deal with variables is actually not dealing with objects, but as you know, either with very low-level data structures, like the fact that instance variables have offsets. So you say, you can say to a point inst var at 1 and you get the x, or you can store something in there, or you can use the named information, but that again is just a symbol or a string that you use conceptually. So you just say there is a variable that is named x, but there is no object describing it. And some years ago we thought that we could do better, and we actually did do better. So if you look at Faro, since some versions, but more publicly over the last versions, that we have something in Faro now that is called slots, which models instance variables, and class variables, which are actually classes too. To understand what that means, I want to explain them very quickly. So what they actually are conceptually is that we have with slots first class instance variables. So that means that every instance variable in the system is described by one instance, which is a subclass of slot, or which is an instance of slot or one of the subclasses. And this is real. So that means that really every variable in the system has an object that describes it. So there are 8,000 instances of this of subclasses of slot in the system. The compiler, instead of hard coding how to read a variable, simply delegates to that object. So as soon as the compiler sees an instance variable when it compiles, or a class variable, it just tells to that object, I would like to read you, however you want to do that. Out of this comes that because it's a normal class, of course you can do subclasses. And it's actually quite easy to do, and there will be a tiny example later. And slowly people are starting to use this, either to make some demos or to actually use it in their own code or even in Faro. And so that means that slowly a small library of useful slot classes is emerging. To explain it a bit more is that we have an alternative class definition to define both slots and class variables. We are still not 100% sure if the name slots here is so great. So if you look at this, especially if you have class variables below, so maybe at some point this will be renamed to instance variables, which would make, I guess, more sense to Smalltalk people. So if you just write a symbol there, then this is by default a standard instance variable. So that means it's an instance of instance variable slot. The reason that we wanted to omit a full definition in that case is that it's just a lot to write, and that would be a bit tedious to do. So that means we have a shorthand which says if we put just symbols there, then this is a standard instance variable. And this standard instance variable, the instance variable slot class, when the compiler asks it to generate code, it just generates standard Smalltalk 80 push instva, store instva bytecode. The interesting thing is where it differs is that these are objects that have an API. So that means I can ask point for its slot X, and I will get back an object. And this object is the one that knows about how to read X from class point. So that means we can ask this object to read from an from one object, or we can ask it to write to an object. So we have read with the parameter of the object that we want to read from, and we have write to store something. We are the slot definition. That's a standard reflective API, and later when we define our own slots on the next slide, it gets clear why we want that. Where it gets interesting is that you can actually then add lots of kind of IDE or scripting methods on top of this API of variables. So one nice thing, for example, that we added is that you can ask a slot object, give me all methods back that use you in some way. And so you get back a collection of all the methods that access this variable. Or you can ask for all AST nodes that access this slot, or you can ask for all assignment nodes only, and then you get back all assignment nodes. So it's kind of nice because it pushes object-oriented design deep into the system where it was not used due to because it was too low level. The read and write, why we have that, gets more clear when we define our own slot in a simple way. So for this is a very simple example where we make a subclass of slot, which is supposed to store the state in the slot instance instead of the instance of the object. And if you think about it a bit, so there is one instance of this class per class that uses this slot. So that means if you think about it, it's a bit the semantics of a class variable. So that means that per class that uses this, the value will be there once. So that if so, that means that if two instances write on it, then it's only there once, and so that means the second assignment will be the value that you will see. So a quite kind of useless example, because we do have class variables already, so this one is not needed, but it's a nice example to show how simple it is to write these things, at least the first version without code generation. So what you do is you implement the two reflective methods. So you say read from the object, in this case you return just value, or you have write to, which assigns value. And this is everything you need to do to be able to use it, because the slot class has as a fallback a code generation. So when the compiler now asks this object, I want to read you, please give me code, it will actually give you bytecode that uses the reflective read method. Or for assignment, it will use this method. This is, of course, quite slow, because it's lots of bytecodes just to call this method, instead of, if you look at a normal instance variable, it's where you have one bytecode that actually does the operation. But it makes it very easy to play with, to start playing with these. So how you then use that is that you put here in the slots definition, you put then the name and then which kind of slot it is. And and that's now a special kind of instance variable which uses the semantic that we defined in the read and write method that you saw before. So we can now compile a normal read, a normal assignment, and the compiler will make sure that behind the back it will generate the code to do what we defined. And if you do that, so this is actually in Faro 8, you can play with that. If you inspect the slot, then you see that the value will end up in it, and you can follow what happens. There is more. So the most important thing is, of course, bytecode generation, because the whole idea is the compiler asks this class, oh, make me bytecode. And if you would always do this reflective read fallback, it would be always very slow. So that means you can override emit store and emit value and use the method builder of the compiler to emit exactly the bytecode that you need to do what you want to do. This is something that is quite important because else it's too slow. But on the other hand, to get started, it actually is not important because from a semantical point of view, the other thing is fully enough, so to implement read override. Then there are some nice things. So the class builder, when it puts together a class, it will call on all the slots installing in so that the slots can actually get active and do something to that class. So we have, for example, slots that add another instance variable to the class when it gets built, for example. Or you could, there's as a demo, which I don't think makes sense in practice, but as a demo, there is a slot that creates accessors for itself on definition time of the class. I don't think that you would want to use that, but it's kind of a fun demo to see. Another thing is that you, conceptually, it would be nice if on new, every slot would get, after it gets instantiated, it would get handed over the instance so that it could do something to it. Of course, changing new in the system would slow down things quite a lot, especially as we don't use this mechanism too much. So what we added for now is that a slot can implement once initialization, and if that returns true, then we make sure that on class build that we create an initialize method that actually contains the hello slot instances, here's a new, we created a new instance, you can modify it. And then the final one that you can use is you can make slots invisible. So you can actually add a slot that you do not see anywhere because it's hidden. That means it's there, you can compile code that accesses it, but when you ask the class, give me your instance variables, it doesn't show anything. This is a bit experimental because it has some implications that we are still looking at, but it's kind of nice for building slots that, for example, add additional state to an object. So we started to play with this, so there are lots of demos and even some users, as we will see later. So we have, for example, property slot, which stores which stores its data in a dictionary instead of in instance variables. So that means it can be indefinitely large, and you can and if you define a lot of property slots, then they actually only use space as soon as you need them, as you use them, but of course you pay the overhead of the property dictionary. So that is always the thing. Boolean slot, which is kind of a fun slot. So it all the booleans of the hierarchy will be collected and stored in one integer. And then the bits of that integer will be read to see if it's true or false. And that means you can encode all your Boolean flags in one object, which can be quite nice. So if you look at graphical systems like Morphic, you have lots of flags, and they get at some point, it gets too wasteful to use Booleans for them, and then people start to implement a flag integer, so like a bit field, and this one does it for you, and you still can use it like a normal instance variable. But you can only assign true or false to it. Then unlimited instance variables stores the instance variables in a second array so that you can actually make it as large as you want at the expense of being a bit slower because you always do add put. Then we have history slot, which stores the last 10 values, process local slot, which is local to the process, computed slot, which computes from a block the value cannot be assigned to, relation slot models, relationships, bidirectional. Lazy and initialized slot are two versions of slots with default value, one that works lazily, so it does an if-nil check on read and returns the default value if it's nil, and when you assign, it assigns normally. And initialized slots is a bit like initialized method, so that means it initializes on new. And we have computed slot double, so yeah. And then another one, observable slot, which is used in spec, and write one slot, which is a demo to have a variable that you can only write once. So they start to be used. In Faro, we have one user, which is spec, which uses an observable slot that announces change to the graphical entities, very nice. Then in PharmX, in Moose, it's used a lot for relations and for metadata, so that you can tag instance variables. Then there are other external projects, like the typed slots project, which uses this to have a type capability. So now we have the basis to actually think about the problem. And I think from the time, that's very good to move to that. So let's just take two examples. Let's take the observable slot, which we already use, and then the idea to be able to have a default value. I want to have the two at once. So that means a lazy slot, for example, would be defined like this, and the second class definition has an observable slot. And I want to actually want an observable slot with a default value for the same variable. So what can I do now? So what is of course clear is I can implement my own lazy observable slot by just implementing read and write, and in a second iteration maybe make it fast using bytecode emission. But as I have already both implementations, it's a lot of copy and paste, and I can even subclass one of the two, and it would be perfectly possible and not a huge problem. But as we have seen, there are so many slots that this would lead very quickly to a combinatorial explosion. So in the end, especially if you want to combine three different slots, or if we would have more kinds of slots, this is not a good idea. So what I would like to do instead is I would like to be able to write something like this. So really like observable slot plus lazy slot with default 5. In a class definition, it would then look like this. So at first, this looks, you could might think like, oh yeah, that's traits, we just make these traits and then we can mix them together and it should work. But it's not that easy, because the slots that are installed in a class are actually instances, not classes. So we want to compose instances. And then the other thing is that we want to combine behavior, not only use one of the two, but we want to combine them. So you could have three slots at once that want to change what happens before a read or after a write or something like that. So that means inheritance or traits do not solve the problem in this case. So what can we do? So the first thing that we did is that we actually analyzed what kinds of slots do we actually have in the system and what are their properties when we try to combine them. So one that we found is storage slots. Then we found the concept of decorators, and then last we found wrappers, which are the most problematic ones. So the first one, the storage one, is actually a slot that defines how to store data, like an instance wrapper slot. It's clear that you need at least one because you want to store something somewhere. It can be a property slot, an instance wrapper slot, even a computer slot is kind of like a storage slot because it defines where the data comes from. So this one is kind of easy. So we need one storage slot and only one because they are not really composable. It makes no sense to have a property slot combined with an instance variable slot because they just are two implementations of the same concept. So that's easy, one kind of implementation slot. Then the next thing that you find is that there are a lot of decorator slots. So for example, before and after read or write, they want to do something. They might want to just get notified or new to do something. They might just use the class creation hook to change the class in some way. Often these two things are used together. Then a very important one is metadata. So there might be slots that are purely just storing additional data, like some tags that you want to store to know some more about you. For example, if you have generated code. And so that actually turns out to be quite easy. So decorators, we can just combine as many as we want. So doing something before or after a read, we can just do that in order of our composition and no problem. The real problem is the wrapper slots that we have. So what they do is that they wrap on write and unwrap on read. The best example that makes a lot of sense for Smalltalkers is the read slot. So in Smalltalk, I'm sure that when you were a beginner and you learned about the concept of weak references, you said, now I want to make this instance variable weak. And that actually does not work. So you can only make use a weak array or make weak subclasses of your own. So what you do in practice is you wrap something in a weak array. And the weak slot does exactly that. So when you when it actually instantiates the object, it adds an empty weak array of one in that for the slot, using the normal instance variable bytecode, like push. And then what it does is, when you read, it uses add one, and when you write, it uses add one put my value. So it is a, it wraps the real, the it wraps your value into something and stores it into a normal instance variable. The interesting thing is, so for weak array, that's kind of right now very natural and the easiest thing, and maybe we need to keep that forever. But we have others. So another that is very similar is process local, which just wraps it into a process local variable. But others were just using this because it's so easy to implement. Because it's, yeah, it's just a subclass. And so history slot uses it to store the history. So it wraps actually the value into an array of 10, and then it on ordered collection that, it, that you can actually set the size. And then you store the last 10 values or write once. Wraps the value into I think an association which has then the information if it has already been written or not. So the problem now is that even so they are in the current so easy to use, they are really horrible for composition. So the if you think about the weak slot, it actually turns a write into a read on the outer slot. So because I use add put on the array and but on the outer slot, I just read the array. So that's not nice, because if you would now compose them, it would actually turn a write into a read, and it would mess up everything. Another thing is that it cannot compose, because the order is important, that even then it doesn't make sense. If you would compose weak and write runs, then the history collection is weak, but not the values, and would might disappear. Or when, if you do it write once plus weak in that order, then the write goes always to the weak array, and so that means the whole write once doesn't work anymore. So that means wrappers are problematic. The good news is that we think that most and maybe all wrappers can be implemented as decorators plus additional hidden state. So that is something that we will explore. But it is quite easy to support one wrapper. So that means, and it's often that you only need one, so the idea of making something weak, using a wrapper for that is very natural, and we can do that. So let's support one wrapper in our implementation. So the solution now is that we have a, that we make a subclass of slot, which is composed slot, which has one storage slot, where the default is always the instance variable slot. We have 0 to n decorators, and we have maximally one wrapper. And this allows us to do exactly the composition as we want to if we implement it correctly. So that means we implement a plus in a way that it actually creates this composed slot, setting up the composition correctly. And we even did it in a way that we can use composed slots on its own, and it automatically creates the composition with the default slot. So you can just use, like in the old code, initialize slot default 5, and it will actually work and compose it with the normal instance variable slot automatically. So how does this work inside? So to, I only show the reflective thing, and it's actually as simple as you would think. So that means we know our decorator, so we can actually say decorator before read, do whatever you want to do. Then we get either the wrapper or the implementer. So if there was a wrapper, then the wrapper will delegate to the implementer. If not, we use the implementer directly, which is the storage slot. And then we call the after read method on the decorators. And then we return the value. And this implements then a composed read operation on a composed slot object. Of course, we need to do this the same, but on the level of code generation, which is ongoing work. So there is a work in progress implementation. We are currently re-implementing all existing slots to be composable and to explore the wrappers, especially how we can rewrite them. One of the next steps is to see if we can integrate that with Faro itself. Because in, we do have a user of slots, so that means SP observable is actually a wrapper, so that means that would be one of the candidates to look at, because we, it makes a lot of sense to combine an observable slot with an initialized slot, because default values happen a lot in graphical user interfaces. And the last thing that we need to do is we need to actually unify the variable definition for class variables and slots. So for one, we need to implement the whole thing for class variables too, and the second idea is that we need to unify, because there, it would be nice if we could use the same vocabulary for both, and maybe even use the same term. I mean, instance variable instead of slot would then make sense if the definition is unified. And with that, I'm finished, and we have time for questions.
Marcus?
Microphone.
Marcus? So the 5 has to be a literal there. Presumably there's no way to make that variable or a function of the object?
So you can use actually a block there. So if you put a block, then the block will be evaluated. The block, of course, should be a clean block, so it cannot really reference anything outside. It can be a block without parameter, then it gets just evaluated, which might not make a lot of sense, but you can put a block with one parameter, which will be the instance of the object. So that means you can do the typical pattern of a variable is assigned to self, initialize my variable in this with the default slot.
Yesterday, David West mentioned that he wants URLs for each object. So while you were presenting this, I was thinking that you would also include the could also include the slots into the URL concept, and so what are your ideas about that?
Into the URL. So I sadly missed the talk yesterday. To have a URL user concept for variables. So I guess...
So if you can't answer, it's okay, we can talk offline about it.
But what you could do is you could, of course, have slots that generate the path to access them via some REST API, if that is what you want to do.
No.
Oh, I don't know. I said we missed the talk, so I do not exactly know.
There was just one side remark in the in the talk yesterday. And the other question is, are you planning for an... protocol in class object to have also an instance-based access to the slot, so that I can say, not using the access method, which is for the you gave the example with a point. So a point X is obviously executing an access method. That's clear. But I want the point 0.0 at 5. And have the an object that takes the X slot, so I can wrap the object as an special object that just access the X slot of the single point.
So what we can do right now, so there is a version of traits where you can actually put. The trait, so traits with state can have slots inside, and this works with them too. And there is a version of traits that you can install on objects. So you could actually put a slot in a trait, and so-called talent, and then install that talent on an object. So on only 5 at 5, and it would have then another variable. So that would be possible. Another thing we were thinking was to be able to redefine slots on a per object basis, so that if I have an object in hand and I would want to make for that object my slot somehow special, that you should be allowed to do that. So to add on a per object basis by using an anonymous subclass to add a specialized version of a slot. I don't know if that would be what you wanted to do. I don't think so. Any other questions?
Marcus, order of the decorations is important, yeah?
The order is important, yes. So it actually retains the order, because else. So one thing that we have is that all slots, when they get actually composed, they get called some check. The check method is called on them, so they can actually decide if they want to be composed or not. So if the composition is compatible, and order is quite important for that.
I notice that you don't have parentheses on your work here.
Yes, it uses some evil trick.
And I guess what I'm wondering is if you had two of the decorators that had the same arguments.
Yeah, so right now, if you do this, so what it does, so every slot actually declares which API it wants to expose, and the composition does not understand handler to actually then forward it to all those that actually declared I want the default. Which of course, if you only put one default 5, then and two understand it, they would both get 5. If you want that different, then you need to start to put parentheses around things. Yeah, that's the idea. So there's a bit of magic in that, and it's a bit. Yeah, we will see. So it needs to be actually used a bit to see how far the magic works and when it breaks down.
Can you use traits to do this composition? Like when the variable has the same name?
So what you can do is that you can put the slots into traits, because traits with state, they have slots. So that's possible. You can actually, if you build your trait class, you can use slots traits for that. So it might even be interesting to see if there's something that we can actually move to traits to make the building of slots easier. I have not yet really looked at that. Maybe that will be important when we try to merge a bit the class variable and the slot definition, so that they look a bit more similar. Maybe then traits will get more important. Okay, thank you.